Good afternoon. It's Thursday, the 18th of February, 2016, just after 1 o'clock. Welcome to UK Column News. I'm your host, Brian Gerrish. With me in the studio, Mike Robinson. Sunny outside, Mike.
Is it?
It's been sunny since sunrise.
Excellent.
Extraordinary. We're not going to report any other news because we're particularly happy, any other news on the weather. We're particularly happy with the sunshine in Plymouth. On the front of law and order and justice, things are not looking so good. And we're going to start today with a report on Anthony Carling, the Northern Ireland policeman.
Yes, so Belfast Telegraph reporting the results of yesterday's court case. Just a bit of background to this. Anthony had been involved in a court case with Santander with regard to the repossession of a property. He had won that case in 2013. But Santander had attempted to bring that case back to court. Judge at the hearing several weeks ago had decided that he would permit that case to come back to court. Anthony had identified a number of examples of the judge breaking the law. And so he attempted to arrest the judge on the basis of him being a serving policeman. So this article saying that a serving policeman who tried to arrest one of Northern Ireland's most senior judges has been sentenced to 3 months in prison. Now, this is for contempt of court, criminal contempt of court. And it was interesting how this thing developed because whenever the court case was being heard, Brian, the judge attempted to sit in his own court for his own contempt of and prosecute his own contempt of court.
Yeah.
Now, of course, in Northern Ireland, they still run diplock courts, which means there's no jury. So that judge was attempting to be the prosecutor, the judge and the jury. Now, when this was pointed out to him, he backstepped from that and handed it over to the Attorney General. So it was the Attorney General that prosecuted this case yesterday.
But he had to be prompted to recuse himself from the case.
Absolutely, yeah. That is the case. And it seems like right through this process, Anthony describes it as unfair. I would say it's quite more than just being unfair. The whole process has been pretty despicable as far as I can see.
What we've got really, Mike, is judges are now putting themselves above the law. They run their own courts and they make their own decisions. They're untouchable. So no proper investigation as to what went on. It's simply brought back into the same judicial system.
Well, indeed,
which finds against him.
That's right. Now, the Belfast Telegraph article was reasonable up to a point in the sense that they've stated some of the facts of what went on yesterday, but they haven't given any of the background to the case. And so when the judge had heard the case, said, "We are satisfied beyond reasonable doubt that Mr. Carlin was a man driven by self-importance and attention-seeking." This is a pretty disgraceful attempt to dismiss what was the much broader issue of what Anthony Carlin was attempting to highlight here. First of all, was the fraud with regards to the mortgages. And second of all, was the fraud within the court system, which supports the fraud within the mortgage system. So to dismiss what Anthony Carlin was attempting to do in this way is demonstrating the attitude of the establishment in these cases.
And the press as well, Mike, because we are seeing regularly now that reporters either won't investigate or they're not funded to investigate. So there's no in-depth journalism into what actually took place in the case. You simply accuse the person of being attention-seeking and that's the end of it.
Well, that's right. And of course, as I say, the Belfast Telegraph reported the facts, but of course they don't go into the detail of the background. They're effectively lying by omission.
Lying by omission. Well, let's come in at a different angle because this one was sent through to us last night, I think, from Liberty Blitzkrieg. And this is a really excellent article, which I'd encourage everybody to Google and go and have a look at, by a gentleman called Michael Krieger. Victims of billionaire paedophile with ties to Bill Clinton claim federal prosecutors offered sweetheart deal. What's going on here? This is going back to Mr. Epstein. I'll just read you this part of the article. Bill Clinton took repeated trips on the Lolita Express, the private passenger jet owned by billionaire paedophile Jeffrey Epstein, with an actress in soft core porn movies whose name appears in Epstein's address book under an entry for massages. According to, this is according to flight logbooks obtained by Gawker and published today for the first time. The logs also show that Clinton shared more than a dozen flights with a woman who federal prosecutors believe procured underage girls to sexually service Epstein and his friends and acted as a potential co-conspirator in his crimes. Now, what the article is talking about in great depth is a deal done so that Epstein has served the minimum possible time and the whole thing has been gently wiped under the carpet, swept under the carpet. And of course, we'd like to remind people that it was Prince Andrew who was implicated in this case. And what has happened? Well, that has all now gently disappeared. So the journalist makes some really excellent comment on this case. He says this, as I've said time and time again, the greatest cancer of all cancers afflicting these United States is a startling deterioration in the rule of law, specifically the institutionalization of a two-tier justice system in which the rich and powerful can literally get away with murder while poor inner city kids get locked up for victimless crimes. Well, I'd like to just put that comment against this background because yesterday, Melanie Shaw, the child abuse victim from Nottingham, appeared in court again. She got a suspended sentence and a £200 fine. What does British society do to this lady? This is what she's been through. She reports her abuse. When she discovers the police are not fully investigating, she's threatened and harassed, including by the police. She's deemed to be mentally ill. Her son is taken away from her. She's denied legal representation. She's in prison. She's denied medical treatment. She has her house taken. She's denied care in the community. And her medication is refused. And then she's accused again of harassment for sending flowers. And ultimately, she's ended up with a three-year suspended sentence. And she's fined £200 with a surcharge because the courts haven't got money. So what better statement than what's happening in America in the courts? There is no justice. We've simply got judges making up the rules as they go along. And in UK, we've got this victimisation of the victim. It's not only outrageous, of course, it's very dangerous because it means that law is very nearly over in UK. Well, if we want to go to another part of the world where law may be interesting, we need to go to Saudi Arabia. And we were fascinated by this headline that Saudi Arabia and Turkey seem to be rolling back on their decision that we could put troops into Syria. And according to the Mail here, a Saudi diplomat said on Sunday that Saudi Arabia was very serious about sending ground troops into Syria, but will first wait to see whether plans for pause in hostilities are agreed. So that was then supported by other articles, which are actually saying, well, actually, Saudi and Turkey are going to just wait and see what happens before they take any further action. I get the impression, Mike, that somebody's actually told them to get back in their box, or they've decided the situation in Syria is just too dangerous for them to go in.
Well, they've got to be crazy to poke a stick at the bear anyway.
At the bear, yeah. Indeed. Which leads us in nicely to Russia, because, of course, Russia is the big bad bear. Here's the Daily Mail with acres of text space on the fact that the Russians have been flying blackjack bombers close to UK. As I always say, there's nothing very special about this. It was going on all through the Cold War years. Standard practice by the Russians in the same way that the British and the Americans carry out these flights. Or at the moment, the British and Americans are putting troops right up on the Russian border. But the whole article is about the scrambling of two RAF Typhoons. Possibly this is the whole RAF, Mike. I'm not sure how many Typhoons we've got at the moment, but it's not very many. So two Typhoons go up. Here's the inset picture. I thought it was a bit unfortunate because it almost looks like the blackjack is chasing the typhoon, but we better not say that, we'll upset somebody. But this is the important part. This is whipping up anti-Russian propaganda. So the initial story put out by the Ministry of Defence, the Daily Mail promotes it, and the nudge to us is that we should be afraid. In fact, very afraid, because of course they highlight the fact that this aircraft could be carrying nuclear weapons, could be carrying up to 16 nuclear missiles. Well, interesting that the same time this is going on, newspapers such as The Guardian are busy telling us that musicians and scientists have joined a call to scrap the Trident nuclear deterrent. So you can see the public mind being pulled apart here, Mike. We should be very frightened that the Russians got nuclear weapons. But according to The Guardian, this pop group, I think they're called New Fathers, well, they are now the experts on nuclear deterrent, and we should scrap it. This is bizarre stuff. I'm almost at the point of saying, how can you comment on this? Because, of course, it's such utter nonsense.
How can you have it both ways?
How can you have it both ways? Bring in Angela Merkel.
Well, indeed. Yet again, another call for a no-fly zone in Syria. Of course, any time there's been a call for a no-fly zone in Syria, it's because the agents of the West, shall we call them, are in danger, and therefore they need protection. And in this case, of course, the agents of the West are the Al-Nusra Front, ISIS and so on, who are experiencing difficulties as a result of the Russian support of the Syrian government. So Merkel has called for a no-fly safe zone along the Turkish-Syria border for refugees, apparently. But, of course, the definition of refugees is not made. It would be helpful if there were an area in Syria where none of the parties to the conflict launched aerial attacks. So what does that mean, Mrs. Merkel? Does that mean that anybody, maybe somebody, an ISIS member, can sit on the under the no-fly zone and launch their attacks from there? Is that is
one
that
would
the plan?
Have thought so. Yeah.
Yeah. We can't negotiate with the terrorists of Islamic State. But if we were to be able to reach an agreement between anti and pro Assad forces on a kind of no-fly zone in the sense of sanctuary for the many refugees, then this would save many lives and aid the political process about Syria's future. Okay. So there you have it. But the Russians aren't having any of it.
I'm not surprised. Meanwhile.
Yes, meanwhile. Well, this is kind of a sort of reiteration of what Ash Carter had announced on the 2nd of February, which is Obama's new defence budget. Absolutely huge amount of money. And, of course, Ash Carter had originally given this information in a speech to the Economic Club of Washington on February the 3rd. And he detailed Obama's plans. $7.5 billion specifically for the European Reassurance Initiative. Do you feel you need to be reassured?
By the Americans.
By the Americans.
Not at the moment, and we'll come on to one of the good reasons why we shouldn't feel reassured by the Americans.
Do you think that the Americans spending $7.5 billion in order to bring weapons, including tactical nuclear weapons, right up to the eastern borders of Europe is a clever thing to do?
Well, it's not going to calm the situation, is it,
no.
Mike? It is not going to calm the situation at all.
I don't think there's anything else needs to be said there. Okay, so, you know, this is the effect of Western-backed activities in the Middle East. 5 horrible years. This is Libya marking the 5th anniversary since we bombed it to bits, mainly focusing on infrastructure, water systems, power systems, and so on. And of course, this then became a hotbed for ISIS recruitment. So 5 years since we murdered, is that too strong a word?
No, I think it's right, because he was never taken into a court of law, was he?
No, indeed.
Gaddafi.
Talking about Gaddafi. And of course, that uprising and his death was a precursor to NATO-led. Was it NATO-led? According to RT, it was French and British, I suppose, mainly. Bombing Libya, and well, what can you say about it other than it's a disgrace?
Well, I think we're going to mention some of the politicians involved in a minute. But if we're going to feel safe with American military, NSA is going to keep us safe as well.
Yes, because now, of course, the Paris attacks couldn't have happened if the people involved were not able to encrypt messages and communicate using encryption. And this is really one of the really big debates that's going on at the moment, because of course governments and the NSA and GCHQ want access to break into encryption technologies, and some of the corporations seem to be pretending to fight back. They may be fighting back to some degree, but at this point, Apple, for example, saying that they won't provide any backdoors in the iPhone, for example, because hackers could use that, and indeed that's true. But governments don't want the likes of you and I to have access to encryption, because it means that they can't snoop on us.
Yeah, they don't want us to have private conversations. Mm. And as we always say to people, if you're worried about snooping on your emails or telephone calls, the response should be to make more calls, to send more emails, because it's swamping the system, which does the damage. If you don't like the British state or the American state spying on you, communicate more, not less. Well, we shouldn't be happy with American agencies at work. And the canary here, this is another one sent in to us. Thank you very much for whoever sent this through to us. It says that these three British airports, a foreign spy agency decides who can travel. And the picture is of an MP, Labour MP Stella Creasy, and she put in a parliamentary question which revealed that Homeland Security officials, so American Homeland Security officials, are able to prevent British citizens from travelling at three major UK airports, Heathrow, Gatwick and Manchester. So here we are, that we have now got Homeland Security. Many Americans regard this organisation as being very, very dangerous in its powers and capability and brutal way of operating. Now in British airports, telling us whether we can fly or not. And the lady MP said this: many Muslim constituents tell me they've given up on the idea of going to America after hearing stories of Muslim passengers turned away of boarding gates by US officials. We're going to say, did you give your consent to US Homeland Security operating on British soil? The answer is, of course, none of us did. So this decision has just been taken unilaterally by David Cameron, presumably. He has made the decision that we're now going to be checked by American Homeland Security people. No discussion in Parliament, no discussion with British people. This is a dictatorship, Mike.
Indeed.
It's here. It's only a question of can we get enough action by enough people to stop it. It is not a dictatorship coming into position. It's now in position. It's being run by people smartly dressed, suits, butter wouldn't melt in their mouth, David Cameron, Theresa May. And if you want to know what is really going on, then have a look at The Independent. This is quite an amazing article. Boycotting Israeli goods is about to become a criminal offence. So much for power to the people. Now, I think that the journalist who wrote this has really started to think a bit. If we have a look in a bit more detail about the comment, it says, if David Cameron wants local authorities and everyday people to get involved in politics, that's great, but he needs to walk the walk. The government can't take that voice away from people simply because it doesn't like what's being said. And he went on to say, when David Cameron rose to power in 2010, he did so based upon a platform of devolution and pluralism under the highly marketable banner of creating that big society. Westminster unleashed a wide array of initiatives designed to empower local authorities and grassroots activists and give them a stronger voice. That was the dream. Fast forward 6 years, and it's now clumsily attempting to mop up every single trace of hyper-local activism. Well, this is very interesting because, of course, it's been the UK column that has warned that David Cameron has pledged his loyalty to Israel. He says it's unshakable, and therefore Britain must come second, i.e. Israel comes first, it's unshakable, Britain comes second. And of course, it's been the UK column that has also warned that David Cameron's Big Society is a lie, a very big one, in that it seeks total control to the lowest level. How can we prove some of this? Well, simply have a look at what people have been saying. Here's Eric Pickles. He said this: we're going to shake up the balance of power in this country. We're going to change the nature of the constitution, be in no doubt about our commitment to localism. I know I look like an unlikely revolutionary, but the revolution starts here. So this man, Mike, just telling the public what's coming. He's going to break up the constitution. He's going to cause revolution in this country. And now we're starting to see it. And we're starting to see that the state allegiance is to Israel. Well, bring in Mr. Cameron. What did he have to say? It was this: in 2010, Big Society's guiding philosophy, where the leading force for progress is social responsibility, not state control. Well, this is a lie. It includes a whole set of unifying approaches, breaking state monopolies, allowing charities, social enterprises and companies to provide public services, privatisation, making the government more accountable, which is presumably why Mr. Cameron at the moment is closing down freedom of information. And of course, the Conservative blog site and Office for Civil Society freely admitted that the Big Society plan is directly based on community organising as created by the Marxist Saul Alinsky in the States. And we better bring in Clegg, because of course Mr. Clegg was the man largely engineering this in the background, the whole thing a massive lie by Prime Minister David Cameron. And it's been the UK column alone that did the detailed analysis on the Big Society. This one is going back to 2013, where we showed the main components of Big Society, including where the money was coming from. Here's Saul Alinsky. And if we just have a look in a bit more detail, we've got all of the community empowerment groups. We've got Big Society Capital. Here's the big banks: HSBC, Barclays, Lloyds, TSB, RBS. So all of the big banks right at the back of Big Society, Mike, working with the third sector, the charities, the non-government organisations, to create what is a dictatorship. Communitarianism, communism, you can call it what you like, but this is absolutely the state controlling to the lowest level.
Yep.
We can't put it more simply than that. And presumably Israel now pulls Mr. Cameron's strings. Who's really in charge?
Who knows? So, well, right at the heart of this, of course, is constitutional reform. That's what Pickles was talking about. And in the United States, there is a similar initiative going on. This article here is discussing Justice Antonin Scalia, who was a Supreme Court judge in the United States. And, of course, Supreme Court judges keep their jobs for life. So he passed away a few days ago. 13th of February. And so as a result, the Supreme Court and who is going to replace him has become a sort of central issue of the presidential campaign, because theoretically Obama gets to choose the next incumbent. And as I say, it is a job for life, but he is likely to be blocked by Republicans because they consider Obama a lame duck president at this point, and they do not want him to be choosing somebody for such a significant role. So, why is this important? It gets to the heart of the constitutional reform agenda, actually, in both sides of the Atlantic. We have slightly a harder time on this side of the Atlantic because our constitution is written in many documents. And today's politicians are so wrapped up in the idea of their own self-importance that they believe there is no difference between parliamentary legislation and constitutional law. I think there are many people who would disagree with that, but that's certainly their impression and the impression they want to give. But as I say, pretty much the same argument is happening on the other side of the Atlantic as well. Justice Scalia was a constitutionalist. He believed in that the US Constitution stands the test of time, and the principles enshrined in it by the founding fathers stand today. We gave another example, Hillary Clinton standing for the presidential election. Unsurprisingly, she argues that the Constitution is what she calls a living document and that can be changed on a whim to deal with modern issues not envisaged by the founding fathers. So, for example, gun control, snooping, free speech, encryption. These are examples of some of the things which are being extended to the point that they're unconstitutional in the United States, but she feels that that's fine because, you know, these things weren't considered by the people that wrote the original document. Now, of course, that's nonsense. A constitution is the rules by which the nation is governed, and it's there to limit the excesses of, what do we call these people? Psychopathic narcissists? Is that a fair description?
That's fairly close, Mike.
Yeah. So Scalia was right to defend the US Constitution, and as we move through the constitutional reform agenda there and here, I would say that it's a pity that we don't have anyone within our establishment that sort of takes the same stand on these issues.
No, at the moment there doesn't seem to be any single MP who's prepared to pick up the constitutional issue and run with it.
Yeah.
They've dabbled with it, they've skirted around the edges, and we're being told that inside Westminster at the moment, as this European referendum approaches, that MPs simply will not discuss the reality of the Constitution being broken up and European Union clutching the UK ever closer. Mm. So whether that's cognitive dissonance or fear, but British MPs simply won't discuss it now. Well, perhaps we need a good constitutional lawyer like Sherry Blair. Bring back one, there we go.
Yes, well, I mean, this is a pretty staggering article, isn't it? Unsurprising, bearing in mind who she's married to, I suppose. But anyway, her law firm apparently earning £2,000 a day representing arms dealers.
I couldn't possibly believe that. What an outrageous thing to say.
£200,000. But of course, these are people that are now considered con men and terrorists. That's what they're being labelled as by the West. So she agreed to work for President Yameen's dictatorship for 6 months in return for £420,000. She publicly claimed its job was to help build democracy and improve transparency and accountability. And she was paid £210,000 by a businessman who is accused of corruption, arms trafficking, terrorism, and the embezzlement of more than £30 million of public money.
It was probably just a mistake. You know, you're a top law firm, but it's easy to make mistakes over who was paying you money, I should imagine.
Well, it could only happen to a Blair.
Could only happen to a Blair, but I'm sure she's doing good work with children's charities, and what's a mistake of a few million pounds? It's not really a problem. That was sarcasm. I know that occasionally people think that when we say such things, we mean it. It was sarcasm. Well, let's look at what's really coming in Europe, and thank you very much to the lady that pushed this Polish magazine front page at us. Now, this is Wozzicki, if I've pronounced that correctly. It means the network in Polish. And this is a front cover which is clearly showing a woman about to be raped or sexually groped or assaulted. But if you look at the hands, all of the hands, of course, take you to the fact that this is being done by nasty immigrants or refugees. And top right, we've just put, this is... the headline of a couple of the stories, The Hell of Europe, or Does Europe Want to Commit Suicide? So this is a very emotive front cover. And we've just decided to get into this a bit. It says in the new issue of The Network, a report about the media and Brussels elite, that they're hiding from the citizens of the European Union the truth about this massive influx of people. And the writer says the people of old Europe, after the events of New Year's Eve in Cologne, painfully realised the problems arising from the massive influx of immigrants. The first signs that things were going wrong, however, were there a lot earlier. They were still ignored or were minimised in significance in the name of tolerance and political correctness. Now, I find this article fascinating because, of course, the lady is wrapped in the European flag. So we're promoting the European Union. We're promoting the European identity, not a national identity. And it's the white woman who's about to be sexually assaulted by all those nasty Islamic refugees. Well, it goes on. It says, outlining the fundamental differences between Eastern Islam and Western Christianity, culture, architecture, music, gastronomy, dress. The editorial explains these two worlds have been at war over the last 14 centuries. Well, I'm not actually sure that's true, but we'll let it run. And the world is now witnessing a colossal clash of two civilizations in the countries of old Europe. The clash is brought by Muslims who come to Europe and carry conflict with the Western world as part of the collective conflict between native Europeans and their new guests. So there's some pretty good rhetoric in here, Mike. We've got the clash of civilizations. We've been at war apparently for 14 centuries. I don't actually remember seeing that. I've seen fights, I've seen disputes. We've seen localized conflict, but apparently we've been at war for 14 centuries. So we just thought, was this propaganda or lack of understanding? Many people very emotive about immigration and influx of refugees. What was going on here? Immigrants and Islam are the problem. Well, let's remind ourselves of this gentleman. Here he is, Peter Dennis William Sutherland. He's the big boss in the UN Global Forum on Migration and Development. And he said, we need this mass migration in order to break down the identity of European countries. So the policy that's created this mayhem has come straight out of the United Nations, and they're telling us what the policy was going to be. So I think that we should be getting Mr. Sutherland, we need him on the stage somewhere to ask him if he's quite happy with the rape and violence that's come out of his UN policy. But we'll say to our audience, this is the reality of it. Many people deeply upset by seeing the breakdown within countries, obviously happening in Central Europe, but also within UK. Is it the immigrants that are the problem, or is it the people who've actually created the violence and the mayhem which has displaced refugees?
Displaced and driven refugees.
And we've got Mr. Sutherland casually sitting there looking very fat and comfortable, telling us that UN policy is to create mass migration of individuals in order to break down your particular country. So if we've got anybody from the Polish community listening to us, perhaps you might like to get on the phone or send an email and challenge the magazine, Uwziki, and see whether they actually know about Mr. Sutherland and know about the UN policy to create this violence and mayhem in countries. It's all there, Mike. Once you start to assemble the jigsaw, nothing at the moment is happening by accident. We can see that this is clearly tracked back to UN policy. And of course, if we've got a policy, we have to have the money to put things into place, bring in the banks.
Well, this is an interesting article from RT because they're talking about the fact that HSBC decided to stay in London. They're quoting Nicholas Wilson, British-born whistleblower, as they describe him, who claims to have uncovered evidence of HSBC fraud amounting to £1 billion. And he says that the decision by HSBC to remain in the City of London was easy to predict. Speaking to RT on Tuesday, he said the announcement signals business as usual for HSBC and Britain's broken banking culture at large. HSBC is being sued all over the world for its crimes, he said. It should be no surprise that the world's most criminal bankers should stay in the world's financial crime centre, the City of London. And he's absolutely right, of course. And in fact, just, you know, one simple example of how right he is, we should remember that Martin Wheatley, who was head of the Financial Conduct Authority up until June or July last year, he resigned, or was he dismissed? It was never really clear. Did he jump or was he pushed? I think he had no choice either way. George Osborne made sure that he was gotten rid of, because the banks didn't like him. They didn't like him. He was in charge of the Financial Conduct Authority, and they didn't like the job he was doing.
Well, they wouldn't like him actually regulating them and controlling what they're doing.
Exactly. And since he's gone, we've seen the situation just get worse in the regulatory environment. Bank of England not doing their job, Financial Conduct Authority not doing their job, Chancellor of Exchequer not doing his job, and the banks just riding roughshod over everybody, continuing to do so.
Bring in Harry Potter.
Well, bring in Royal Bank of Scotland. Now, this is a bit historical, I suppose. It's only being reported now, but nonetheless, it's interesting. RBS is £1 billion in tax breaks. It was really the most obtuse, is perhaps the right word, piece of tax evasion. What they were basically doing was they were investing in films such as Harry Potter, Batman Begins, Troy. They'd put money into 25 companies, and they would enjoy billions of pounds worth of tax breaks as a result. This was between 1998 and 2007. So the bank's front company would buy rights to a finished movie, and then they would lease that movie back to the studio for release in cinemas and on DVDs. Bloomberg was quoting Joylan Mom, who said these are highly artificial transactions done solely for tax avoidance reasons. It is interesting that a bank which is effectively privatized in some ways was up to this kind of tactic, supported by the government. Now, the law, they say, was changed in 2007, and they say that they immediately stopped this activity as soon as the law was changed. I'm quite sure they found some other loophole to put that money
to follow
instead.
Through.
Yeah.
And remember, of course, that all of these banks are the very people that Julia Middleton, the chief executive of that wonderful political charity Common Purpose, she said these are the role models. In her book Beyond Authority, she talks lovingly about East German bankers and the fact that these people have really got the model to take society forward. Lehman Brothers ultimately went bankrupt. They were promoted as being a role model for school children. And of course, it's Common Purpose that's been working hand in glove with the Cabinet Office. So we're directly there with Oliver Letwin, the powerhouse who is driving the Conservative Party and controlling David Cameron, and his number two, still Francis Maude, together with Common Purpose, promoting the banks as the people to follow.
She can pick her banks. So Lehman Brothers went bankrupt. Deutsche Bank's about to go bankrupt. So she's doing pretty well.
Well, if you're going to group up the banks so that you've got one world super bank, which will probably come in just at the time the European Union is forming its own treasury, she's done a good job. Mm. And of course, remember that the Common Purpose technique will be Saul Alinsky. So you've got to destroy the old before you can bring in the new. That's what these people believe. And we're seeing the agenda follow through quite nicely.
Gold. Yes, this is an interesting little article. Well, it's only a couple of lines, really, in Zero Hedge and a graph. So the gold spoofer is back, is what they're saying. Overnight action saw gold jerked lower in Europe as Europe opened and Asia closed. Thanks to Nanex, we now see how this occurred as the gold spoofer has returned. Once the spoofer disappeared, gold rallied back up to the overnight highs, and they're asking, was it rigged? And this is basically what happened. So the spoofer activity on the left there with the red arrow downwards, and then once that activity disappeared, the track moved back up again to where it was. Now, what many people are asking is, you know, this is something which is seen quite often. Is this sort of indicative of it's certainly suggestive of the idea that $1,200 an ounce is the limit that the banking establishment is willing to accept at this point in time. The gold market, as we have mentioned many, many times over the years, the most manipulated market of any. We know that part of the reason that the price is suppressed as much as it is because of the amount of paper that's being sold on the markets for which there's no physical gold to back it up. So we've got a fractional reserve system in gold, which is orders of magnitude greater than just in the money in standard credit. So, this is typical of the kinds of manipulations that are going on within the markets, and gold being a prime example of it.
Okay. I think we've got one further one here.
What's that then? This was just an interesting, because it once again highlights the similar activity that happens on both sides of the Atlantic. Because recently, of course, in Britain, we had this story of the lady being stopped as she was attempting to leave the country through an airport for not having paid her television license. And this is an example of the same type of thing going on in the United States. And again, Zero Hedge asking, is the US becoming the land of the debt slave? I think that's going to be the case in Britain as well. They say, believe it or not, the US Marshals Service in Houston is arresting people for not paying their outstanding federal student loans. Paul Acker says he was arrested at his home last week for a $1,500 federal student loan he received in 1987. He says seven deputy US Marshals showed up at his home with guns and took him to federal court, where he had to sign a payment plan for the 29-year-old student loan. This is on the cards for this country as well.
Absolutely. And of course, student loans locking young people into debt even before they've got near a mortgage. And if you're interested in researching the student loan company, you can start off by the fact that it's north of the border now. So that's an interesting situation that you've got the fees on education controlled by a company based in Scotland. That could be really interesting after independence.
It's also interesting that student loans, unlike other debt, doesn't seem to have any kind of limitation on the length of time that has to pass.
It's for your life.
It's for life.
It's for life. Well, that will probably lead us into council tax, I think.
Well, indeed. So the Telegraph here reporting that 9 in 10 council local authorities planning to increase council tax. Local authority information unit surveyed 130 councils and found that 86% are planning to increase council tax this year. Last year, half of them increased council tax. Well, I just wanted to remind everybody, if you go to the UK Column website, actually on the front page at the moment, close to the bottom, are two articles on Section 151 officers. Because these officers are supposed to work for the benefit of you and I. But part of the investigation that John Hirst did into Section 151 officers echoed some research that I did back in 2008 with regard to councils losing money through the Icelandic banks. And so the quote that's in our Section 151 article is about Powys Council in Wales, but this is reflected right across the board. What we've identified is reserves of money held. So we've got usable reserves. So in the case of Powys Council, if you look at their accounts, they have usable reserves of £55.957 million and unusable reserves of £246 million. £260, which gives them a total reserve of £302 million and an income each year from council tax of £60 million. So that means they have quite a number of years of council tax in reserve, and yet they are not only putting council tax up, but they're cutting back on services. And so the question then has to be, why is that? What is this money for? Why is it being held in reserve? Why is some of it unusable? Is it for gold-plated pension plans? What is it for? So in John's article, he suggests an action plan, and I'd like to just read it out here because I think this is something that we need to find out a bit more about, and a bit of pressure coming from the public might be useful. So the action plan is obtain a statement of accounts from the council, from your local council, obtain the budget document for your local council, and locate any mention in those documents of unusable reserves. And if that figure exceeds any cuts, then there are grounds to ask your councillor whether they have been made to services which are required to be provided by an Act of Parliament, and also check that for yourself, because many of these reserves are being kept back as a result of regulations and not as a result of any Act of Parliament. And so Act of Parliament takes precedence over any regulations. And then John goes on to say here, if there are any cuts contrary to statutory obligations, then they should be brought to the attention of the Section 151 officer because of his responsibility to represent the interests of taxpayers. And his report to the councillors should result in the cuts being corrected by a transfer of funds from the reserves, and individuals who have been adversely affected by maladministration may well obtain restitution as described in the article. So do have a look at those articles. But that, you know, follows on from this increase, because the brakes are basically off with regard to increase in council tax. Now there are no restrictions, as far as I know.
No restrictions. And of course, the council simply say that central government is stopping us or reducing the amount of money we get. Therefore, we need to up council tax. So do ask the questions as to where that money is being held by your local authority. Now, just to end with a thank you to those that attended the UK column monthly meeting in the George last night. It was extremely interesting. And thank you to Max for taking us through legalese, one of the big things to unravelling how the government is trying to control us at the moment is to understand the language that's being used in this corrupt court system, understand the language, understand the written language on not only court documents but official public documents, and we're well on the way to unraveling this network that's being put around us. And one of the comments that came up is what we should be doing is surrendering. That doesn't mean surrendering as in giving up, but it means basically pushing all of this nonsense back towards the people who've created it, saying, well, thank you very much, but we don't want it. This is actually quite a powerful way of dealing with some of this immense rules and regulations being thrown at us. And we're going to try and cover this in more detail over the coming weeks. We've also got an update coming on the work of John Hirst. There's been a lot going on in the courts. We're still working on the grand juries. We know that there's been a lot of progress on mortgages at the moment to expose the banking fraud behind mortgages. So there's got a lot of good work going on at the moment, and there's a lot of reason for thinking that progress is being made. Apart from anything else, many people now saying, if you look at the establishment, you can see the fear. They're throwing in more and more propaganda, more and more blatant nonsense in front of the public. And we're entitled to laugh at it, because nothing hurts David Cameron more than people simply laughing at him because he's become irrelevant. Mm. So if we can cheer you up a bit today, that's the thought we'll leave you with, plus the fact the sun is still shining in Plymouth. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.